Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Very good. You remembered. Good job. Welcome to worship at Hope United Methodist Church. It is a joy to be with you on this Sunday as we come to celebrate our resurrected Lord and continue in new life with him. I am Pastor Jeff. I am one of your pastors. Pastor Hale is taking a few days to be with his family and his mother, especially in South Korea, where she had surgery on her back. She did get through surgery well and is in recovery now, but he will be there through the 17th. And so we pray for him, but are glad that he's away. We also, you will note, Cheryl is not here. She's taking a few days rest as well. So we are delighted to have Diane Gallagher with us. Thank you, Diane, for playing. We are glad all of you are here. We are especially glad if we have any new guests with us today. We hope that if you are a new guest, you will stop by in the fellowship hall for a time of fellowship and to pick up a gift bag that is there for you. That is just a small token of our appreciation for worshiping with us this day. Well, this morning we conclude our series on Peter with one of the most poignant conversations in the Bible. You and I, to our loved ones, to our friends perhaps even, we say, "I love you" all the time. But how do you know if someone loves you? I invite you to ponder that this morning as we worship. I hope in the simple act of greeting one another, we can be honest and let our care and love show to each other in our eyes and in our voices. So let us stand and greet each other with the signs of and peace of Christ. So let us join together as we remain standing for our call to worship. Jesus said, Jesus said, Jesus said, Jesus said, in response, we say, "Here's my heart, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above." Let us worship God with all our hearts this morning as we continue our worship with our opening hymn, "Jesus Calls Us," number 398, and we will sing verses 1, 2, and 5 together.
Jesus' sake,
Jesus calls us by thy mercies, Savior, may we hear thy call. Give our hearts to thine obedience, serve and love thee best of
And now let us come to God through our opening time of prayer. Let us pray. God of second chances and God of new life, we have spent our days wandering. Like Peter, we have milled about through nearly every state of faith. We have had courageous days and convicted days, learning days, and questioning days. We have days where we have run to you, Daves for diving out of the boat, Daves for deep joy, and days where the pain of the world feels too close to bear. So as we bring our wandering hearts to you, we ask that you draw us in. Allow Peter's story of grace to give us pause and pull us to you. Dear Lord, we are listening this moment. Speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so I'd invite the kids forward for a message just for you.
This is where children belong. Welcome the heart of the worshiping throng. Wander down and talk now and long. This is where children belong.
All righty, I want to show you all a picture today, right? Ever seen a bowl like that? It looks cracked, doesn't it? It looks cracked, but look at all that beautiful little gold in there that put it back together. Actually, it's not, because here's another one, right, where you can see the gold even more, right? Yeah, this is a Japanese art form that takes something broken and turns it into something beautiful. See those? With filling it in with gold and putting it all back together. Look at those. Isn't that so cool? So let me ask you, have you ever broken something?
Yeah?
How many of us have broken something, right? Look at that. Look at all those hands up there, right? Maybe it was a bowl like this. Maybe it was a candlestick, maybe. Maybe you said something or did something that hurt someone else, right? Or maybe someone said something and did something that hurt you, right? We've been talking about Peter all through these weeks of Lent and now Easter, and we're wrapping up. And you know what? Peter was feeling very much like a broken bowl, right? Do you know why? Do you remember why Peter might have felt like a broken bowl? Because he denied Jesus, right? Three times. Yes, three times. He said, you know, I'm not one of Jesus' disciples, even though he was. So, and he felt really, really bad about it. So that even, we're going to hear a passage in a minute, even after he meets Jesus, after the tomb is opened and Jesus is brought back to life, and they gather as the disciples and Jesus, Peter doesn't know what to say. Uh-oh. He doesn't know what to say, right?
Sometimes I don't know what to say.
I know, right? Yeah. I know, it's hard. It's hard. So Peter doesn't know what to say. So you know what Jesus says? Jesus asks Peter a question. Do you love me?
Yes.
And Peter says, yes, Lord, of course I love you. And Jesus asks again, do you love me? And Peter says, yes, Lord, of course I do. And he asks a third time, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you, right? And in that act, Jesus helped Peter go from broken to beautiful and to become the disciple and the follower that Peter always wanted to be but couldn't find a way of doing on his own.
Wait, I have a question. So yes. It started like this hot. Thanks. But then, became the other pot.
He was the broken pot, and then he became the beautiful pot, right? Because he was put back together, right? Because Jesus forgave him, but Jesus also helped him find his purpose for life and helped him return to being a beautiful individual, okay? So let's have a prayer together, and I hope you'll repeat after me. Dear Lord, thank you for fixing what was broken. And mending what has been torn, including sometimes our hearts. Thank you for loving us. Help us to love you in return by loving others. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you can go with Miss Kate. I hope you have a great day.
Thank you. We ask ourselves, Lord, when did we see you? When were you hungry, cold, or locked away? If you love me, then feed my sheep. If you love me, then feed my lambs. Love one another as I love you. If you love me,
if you love me, then feed.
Today's scripture comes from the book of John, chapter 21, verses 1 through 19. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "Is that the Lord?" Then Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord. He put out his outer garment, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, follow me. The word of God for the people of God. Amen.
And now would you pray with and for me, please, in a moment of silent prayer. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have you ever been completely stressed out? Yeah? Have you ever felt totally overwhelmed? Yes? Some of you might say, yep, that was yesterday, thank you. Right? That was yesterday. What do you do when you feel like that? What do you do when you try to gather yourself and center yourself in that moment, huh? What do you do? Well, Peter, he went fishing, right? He went fishing. He had had enough, right? He had simply had enough. And, you know, we can understand, think about all that he has been through in the last few days of this story, right? He is there. He has denied Jesus in fear. He has heard this crazy story from the women. He has run to the tomb to find it just as they said, to see burial clothes without a body. He was there when Jesus appeared in the locked room. And then there again for the encore performance a week later. He had seen it all, and maybe it was just too much to take in, too much to understand, too much to deal with. And so he did what many of us are very likely to do when we are near collapse. He went back to what was familiar. He went back to the beginning. He went fishing, and his friends went with him. He went not only to go fishing, but he went to that lakeshore, that same place where it all began. And I have to think he was hoping that somehow in doing so, he could just start over, start fresh. Maybe he was hoping that there where Jesus had called him, he could find the words he so desperately needed to say. For us, it's been a week since Easter, but for Jesus, actually, it has been about a week since Easter, at least maybe two. He has seen Jesus. He has both seen the empty tomb, but he's seen Jesus in the flesh, and yet he has not, according to any John's gospel, been able to say anything to Jesus himself. No words between Jesus and Peter have been spoken since that night when rash promises were broken. That's why when the stranger appears on the shoreline and John says, "It's the Lord," Peter is out of the boat like a shot. He can't wait. He cannot wait for them to row in. He jumps. He puts on his coat first, which I find really interesting. He puts on his cloak and then dives into the water, swimming as fast as he can to get to his master. And yet still, once he arrives, he cannot find the words. And the silence remains until after breakfast, and what I envision anyway is a long walk with the two along the shore. It is Jesus who must speak first. "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And so what is often called the reconciliation of Peter or the commissioning of Peter begins. And that's what some call it, but you know, does this really sound like the usual story of forgiveness? Think about it. Not once has Peter said, I'm sorry. Not once. And Jesus does not say, it's okay, Peter. Things happen. It's okay. No. Jesus asks, do you love me? He doesn't say, you know, don't be down. Everyone makes mistakes. He asks, do you love me? Just as Peter never said, I'm sorry, we note Jesus never says, I forgive you. He asks, do you love me? And those are frightening words, are they not? A simple question and yet frightening words. Do you love me? Now, Laura and I tell each other, I love you all the time. And I hope that you do with your loved ones. We say it all the time. But do you love me is something else. Can we understand each other on this point, right? For example, right now there are United Methodist pastors all around the world either waiting for or avoiding a call, right? We know what we're talking about here. We're United Methodists. It's appointment season. They're either waiting for or avoiding a call from their DS. And can you imagine picking up that phone and having your DS say, do you love me? No, not good. Not good. No, right? When we hear that question, we really know one of two things, right? We know we're in trouble or we're about to be, right? We know that because that is one of the few questions I know that can be asked that is not answered adequately by words. Only actions. Do you love me? So what is going on in this story? I believe this story is actually the culmination of Peter and Jesus's entire journey. It is the culmination of all the stories that we've heard this Lent before. And in this moment, Peter, you see, Peter needs more than just absolution. He needs more than just forgiveness. He needs restoration of his spiritual center. As I shared with the kids, he needs restoration of his purpose. And I don't think he's alone. Author Marva Don writes, our society has lost its spiritual center. Too many children, teens, and adults don't have any purpose for their lives. They are bored because of a severe lack of meaning, and they are unable to see possibilities for finding it. Peter needed to find his spiritual center. He needed to know how much he needed Jesus. And that's always what that question, do you love me, provokes in us, right? In my family, I am outnumbered in the gender category by at least 2-1. And so romantic comedies are a big part of our TV watching experience, right? I get to watch a lot of those at home, you know. And just as my preferred genre of sci-fi or fantasy has its own patterns, well, romantic comedies, they have their own patterns. And one of those patterns goes something like this, right? One of the characters, usually the guy, is such an idiot that the other character, usually the girl, has to press the issue. Do you love me? Right? So that the idiot can wake up and realize how much he does need this other person in his life. He needs the question to wake up. See, this relationship between Christ and Peter, it is more than master and teacher. This relationship between Christ and us is more. It is a love story. At its heart, it is a love story. And so Jesus does not minimize Peter's guilt, and he does not say that everything's okay, because Peter needed to be confronted. Peter needed to realize just how much he needed his good shepherd in his life, and so must we. It is quite possible, friends, to believe that Christ died for our sins, to understand how much God loves us, and yet never realize how much we need that love. How much we need the shepherd to be in our lives, guiding and sustaining us each and every day. Listen to Jesus' plea. Do you love me? But understanding how much we need Christ is not the end of the story either, because Jesus had something else to say. Every time Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" and every time Peter responded, "Yes, Lord, you know that I do," Jesus had another response. "Feed my sheep. Feed my lambs. Feed my sheep." We must also realize how much Jesus needs us to continue his work as shepherd. The community that this Gospel of John was written to was facing a crisis, you see. Much like, I think, the crisis that Peter and the disciples did in this story, Jesus knew he was leaving soon. Well, as this John's gospel was written, it was written near the death or after the death of the beloved disciple John, the last of the 12 to walk the earth. Can you imagine what the church was feeling? Right? How will we know our shepherd? How will we know Jesus now that the last witness is gone? How can we move forward? And God's answer is, the shepherd is within you. The shepherd is within you. When Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" I hope that Peter might have remembered some other words Jesus once spoke about love. Earlier in that gospel, before Jesus' death, he was teaching his disciples and he said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. In a little while, you will no longer see me, but you, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live." But it starts with, "If you love me." Do you hear it? If you love me. Jesus wasn't asking, "Do you love me?" to make a point. He wasn't trying to shame Peter or even to forgive him. He asked because he needed to know. He needed to know if Peter could be the one that he had promised Peter to be, the rock upon which the church was built. He needed to know, "Do you love me?" And in that moment, Jesus handed Peter his shepherd's staff. The same responsibility that has been handed to us from that moment through the generations of our church to all who followed Peter, you and me. "Feed my sheep," he said. We cannot be shepherds alone. But our shepherd resides within us so that we can follow. We can follow Jesus. We can care for the community. We can reach out in love to the stranger. We can even travel the path of the cross if we need to, because our shepherd is with us if we love him. Shepherd and storyteller Peggy Godfrey tells a story about her two dogs, Dingo, an old stock dog of hers, and Toby, a young Great Pyrenees. In 1997, in January of 97, she says, Toby and a car collided during a snowstorm. He was killed on impact. Neither of my other two dogs cared much for Toby, since he was the new kid on the block, three times bigger than either of them. He had his own work and did not fraternize. When the sheep were in the home pasture, Toby spent his nights out at the end of the driveway barking in response to nearby coyotes. I appreciated his distant barking, she said. But a few nights after Toby's death, I heard a distant barking again that sounded awfully familiar. Dingo was out at the end of the driveway, barking at coyotes just as Toby had done. She has continued for the past 2 years, Godfrey says, to stand sentinel in Toby's place. Her breeding has gifted her with qualities which made her a useful stock dog, but it is from somewhere else in her personality that this aging dog has learned a new behavior of another critter she wasn't even fond of. Do you love me? Jesus calls. Feed my sheep. May our lives be our response, church, and may it be a resounding, yes, Lord, you know we do. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
More love to thee.
then shall my latest breath whisper thy praise. This be the parting cry my heart shall rise. This still its prayer shall be, more love, O Christ, to thee, more love to thee, more love to thee.
We know how much the Lord our God loves us. By the way, Jesus lived, died, and was raised again for us. In response, in gratitude, we offer a portion of ourselves back to God, back to the church, through this offering. I invite you now to give your tithes and offerings to God. Would the ushers please come forward?
Above all else,
Please be seated. And so we now come to this table to receive the gifts of the Lord. Let us join together in the prayer of the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of bread. And the power of your Holy Spirit, your church, has continued in the breaking of the bread and sharing of the cup. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us join in the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so I would invite those who are helping to serve communion to come forward now as I make this invitation to you all. This is Christ's table, not ours alone. And Christ invites all who wish to come and draw closer to God through Christ to come and receive a piece of the bread, which is gluten-free, and take a cup, take both elements before returning to your seats. Here, let me. You don't want to do that? Okay, you'd get those two? Yep, you take one of these in. There we go. Come. The body of Christ broken for you. Sorry. Body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Christ broken for you. This means God loves you. This means God loves you. This means God loves you. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Weigh in the body of Christ. Body of Christ broken for you. 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 And see the body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken. Trudy, the body of Christ broken for you. Frank, the body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Linda, the body of Christ broken for you. Norm, the body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Chris, my friend, body of Christ broken for you. Broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ here. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Sylvia, the body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for Mary. The body of Christ broken for you. Broken for you. Body of Christ 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 broken for you. Colin, body of Christ broken for you. Denise, the body of Christ broken for you. Anthony, the body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you, Patty. Bob, the body of Christ broken for you. Neil, the body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. You got it. Okay. No. That's all right. We're all good. Steps. So it is our great joy today not only to celebrate in communion with one another, but to welcome a new family to our church. And so I'd invite Jeff, Chuck, Randy, and Sean to come forward. There they are. Dear friends, it is my joy to introduce to you Chuck Bickford, Jeff Benedict, and their sons, Randy and Sean. They are coming from another denomination, but have been members of Christ Church for many years. But they have decided that they have found a home with us here at Hope United Methodist Church, and so we are delighted to welcome them into membership today. And as we discussed, I just have two questions for you this day. As members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church? Do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, say, I will. As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say, I will. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to you and ask, will you do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love? If so, will you give us a hearty amen? Welcome. Let us welcome our new family into our household. We are so delighted to have you be with us. Thank you for joining us. Thank you so much. I hope you will greet them after the service and in the weeks ahead and get to know them better as a part of our church. We pray our blessings upon you in this place. Please be seated. Well, as we conclude our service, we have quite a few prayer concerns and announcements to share with you. And first, I must be the bearer of bad news that Penny Dwyer passed away last night. So we pray for Paul. We pray for Becca and the entire Dwyer family. We do not know much more about a service or anything else yet. I hope to visit with the family soon. But please keep the Dwyers in your prayers as well. Jody asked for prayers for the Sommer family. They lost their 18-year-old daughter and sister on Friday. So a lot of loss today. Prayers, too, for Ronnie, from Ronnie Villanueva for his father. Gerard? Did I get that right, Ronnie? Gerard, thank you. Father turns 97. Turned 97. Prayers for continued health and prayers for his father. Remember those as well. Friends, you've been praying for my parents, and I thank you for those prayers. My father has not been improving. We found out recently that he's had another stroke within the past 2 weeks. So our family has made the painful decision to enter him into hospice care. So we do not expect his passing to be imminent. We think it will be months, but we have entered him into hospice care. I will be traveling to see them sometime in the near future. I was expecting it to be next Monday. Much will depend on conversations with the Dwyer family. I will be away. Pastor Hale is, of course, away. He will be back on the 17th, so we will work through all of that. We ask for continued prayers for Pastor Hale's family and especially his mother. Please remember them in your prayers as well. We have other things happening. The Enough Stewardship Campaign is beginning next Sunday. Enough is discovering joy through simplicity and generosity, and it will be our worship focus for 4 weeks. We also have a 4-week small group that Carrie is going to be leading, and that will be on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. via Zoom online. So anybody, you can join us from anywhere for that. We will have books available next week for that small group study. If you're interested, there's a sign-up sheet outside the doors, or you can use the QR code outside the doors to sign up as well. And on April 21st, our green team will have an Earth Day fair in the fellowship hall, both before and after church. We hope you will join us in there as well. And finally, one other thing. This is somebody's phone. It was left near a RAV4 outside. If this is yours, come see me as you leave the church. I'll be happy to return it to you. We have heard the word, we have been fed, now let us depart to serve and follow Jesus' command to love one another. As we depart, let us stand and sing our closing hymn, number 634. Now let us rise from this table. Let us sing. From this table rise.
disciples of Christ. And as you go, may God go before you to show you the way. May God be above you to protect you, beneath you to hold you up, beside you to be your friend, and inside of you to give you peace. Amen.